do before the night is over? You tell me, Brother Murray, you said there, said, man, we should have called in sick tonight.
No, well, this is good.
By the way, please pray for Sister Peggy and pray for Sunshine. Sunshine never missed a service, but tonight, man, they sound to us like an old man. How are you doing? So they don't sound pretty good. So please keep them in prayer too. I would appreciate it very much. Introduction to the Oneness Doctrine. What we're going to cover in this first part is theological definitions. That is what we're going to cover. What in the world does that have to do with the Oneness Doctrine? If you can catch part of these definitions and keep it in your mind when you talk to not just volunteers but other type of faiths too, it will help you tremendously to explain to them what you believe, and then you also know what they believe. So right. When you talk to them and they said they are Trinitarian, then you can actually come to them and say, this is what Trinitarian definition mean. If they come to you and say there is three gods in the Godhead, then you can tell them, they said they're Trinitarian, you can tell them, well, you're not a Trinitarian. What do you mean? A Trinitarian don't believe in three gods in the Godhead. A tritheist believe in that. That's one of the definitions that we're going to cover. And then you can actually approach them from that angle. So let's do the first one. Are we there? Apologetics. There you can see that you can fill that in, fill in the blank or the open space there. The root word means to defend, to make reply, to give answer, to legally defend oneself. As a subdivision of Christian theology, apologetics is a systematic argumentative discourse in defense of the divine origin and the authority of the Christian faith. So next time when a doctor come up here and come and teach to us and he said, I'm going to give you some apologetics here, then you know exactly what it means because you already have it in your background. The second definition is apostasy. The Greek word means revolt. It is a deliberate renunciation and abandonment of the faith that one has professed. In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12, you'll get an answer for that and to explain to you what apostasy is. Or in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, I'll read you just that one. 1 Timothy 4, verse 1 said, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the later times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctors of devils. That is somebody that had come in the apostolic doctrine and then moved away from them or come out of the church and said, I don't believe in God anymore. This is apostasy. Apostolic. That's the third definition. Belong to, relating to, or traceable to the New Testament apostles. So when you call yourself an apostolic, that is traceable back to the New Testament apostles. Not 325 after Christ, but to the New Testament apostles. These ecclesiastical writers are up to say the apostolic age, meaning the period of the church history between from Pentecost to the death of the Apostle John. All the apostolic doctrine indicate the beliefs of the apostles as revealed in the scripture, or the apostolic practices, meaning those that practice common among the apostles of the early church, such as water baptism by immersion in the name of Jesus Christ, Galatia, which is Holy Ghost speaking in tongues, pray for the sick, laying of hands, regular worship and allowance of the operation of the gift of the Spirit. That is what an apostolic is. So next time somebody said, explain to me what is an apostolic? Well, I don't know. They just call a church that apostolic church. Well, now you have a definition that you actually can take and explain that in theological terminologies across the Trinitarian belief and also the oneness belief. Point number four, atheism. Somebody that is an atheist, this is a definition of an atheist. The Greek word from atheos, that means without God. An atheist, theos is God. Atheos is somebody that don't have God, is without God. The term indicates the assertion or belief that there is no divine being, found only once in the New Testament, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, that's where you can find that. Am I too fast? Are we? Does this help a lot?
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. We find the jackpot for Brother Marie's teaching.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. If I had to spell this stuff for you, we'll be here till tomorrow morning. Let's go on. Number five, Baal. Baal is a generic term meaning Lord or Master in small letters, which became applicable as a name for many different deities. That is why when you hear that they worship Baal, then what they have done, they take a statue or make a statue out of something,
right,
and they, that's a Baal, that's a deity, and they worship. Just put the name on top of it and worship it. You remember, you probably see a lot of this Chinese obese guy that with his fat belly, bald head. What they call his name? Buddha.
Buddha.
He is one of the deity that they just put a name to it, which is Baal. Point number six, begotten. Now we come in also with, you're going to talk to somebody and say that Jesus Christ from eternity. No, he was not. Okay, he was not. I'm going to get to that. I don't want to run myself. But he was begotten. A New Testament term generally means only when referring to Jesus. It was the only of his kind. There is none like it before, and there will be none after it. And translated from the Greek, monogenes. From monos, meaning only, and genomai, a root word meaning to generate, to become, or come into being. And the Bible always talk about the begotten, only begotten Son of God. So when a Trinitarian come to you and said that he was from eternity, that is the Son, the flesh, was the only begotten. There was none before him, there was none like him, and there will be none after it. It's begotten, okay? Or number seven, binatarianism, that is also not a belief, binatarianism. The belief that there are two divine persons in the Godhead, namely God the Father and God the Son, so they have now two gods in the Godhead. Not two persons, but two gods in the Godhead. So when you talk to somebody and say, well, I believe there is God the Father and God the Son, but I'm a Trinity. No, you're not a Trinity. You are Binitarianism. That is who you are. So it is always very important for you to understand the terminology so you can deal with these individuals when you talk to them. When he said, well, I believe then in God the Son, then you can also approach them and say, let me ask you a question. Can you show me one scripture in the Bible that said God the Son?
It's not in there.
No. So if he cannot show you, then by that approach, then you can say, let me show you what the scripture said. The scripture always says the Son of God,
the Son of
not God,
right.
The Son.
Right.
So it's good to know this. Point number eight, Christ. The title used for Jesus in Matthew 16:6 and Acts 2:36, referring to his position and works as Messiah. Christ came from Christos, which is employed to translate the Hebrew word Messiah. Both terms mean anointed one. Okay, point number nine, Christology. Christology is the doctrine of or concerning Christ All that relates to the history, the person, and the work of Jesus Christ. The study of how Jesus relates to the Godhead and how the Godhead future is eternity. His eternity is the earthly sonship and is positioned as both Prince of Peace and the Mighty God. Simultaneously, the promised Son and the Everlasting Father, Isaiah 9 verse 6. The traditional Christian position on the person of Jesus Christ was formulated at the Council of Chalcedon in AD 451, which affirmed that Jesus Christ was one person with two natures, human and divine. That is what Christology means. Not two gods, but two natures.
Right.
Human and divine.
Right.
Point number 10, co-equal. The Trinitarian believe that each person of the divine Trinity is equal to the other in power and attributes. That is what the Trinitarians use. They are co-equal. Point number 11, co-eternity. The Trinitarian believe that each person of the Godhead has always existed and will always exist with a separate identity and position. We know that the Bible said that Jesus was the only begotten at the beginning.
That's right.
Not eternity,
right,
but at the begotten Son.
Right, right.
So when you talk to somebody, you can ask him, show me the scripture that the eternity Son came into existence. Cannot show you scripture.
That's right.
It's not to argue, but it's right, for you to understand right, and right, use approach. Because my approach to somebody on this topic or this point might be different than your approach. So use the Holy Ghost that's within inside
right,
of you and ask God to guide you, to give you the answer, to talk to that individual. Because each person changes also in character. Ask God to show you how to deal with that individual on that specific point. The theism. The belief in two separate and distinct gods, small letter. The term was sometimes applied, that's on page 2, applied by the more orthodox scholars of the Iranians, who were said to believe in one God, the Father, who is eternal, and one God, the Son, not eternal. So it is different from Binitarianism, okay? So you got this very close related, but
right,
it's separate them, okay? So Binitarianism, they believe there is God, the Son, and God, the Father. Here in Dittism, they believe that God is eternal, but the Son is not eternal, okay?